Bayer Manor Audio presents Sonnets and Sunspots, Dr. Research Baxter and the Bell Science Films, by Eric Niderost. Your reader is Nat Segaloff. Acknowledgements. They say that writing is a solitary profession, and to an extent this is true. But no book can be completed without the help of others. This work is no exception. At the risk of sounding like an Oscar winner, there are many people who I'd like to acknowledge and thank. The Baxter family. First and foremost, Lydia Morris Baxter, Frank Baxter's daughter, was very generous with her time and her memories. She was very patient at answering my numerous questions, questions that in many cases only she could answer. Lisa Baxter Garber, grandniece of Dr. Baxter, has not only been a great source of information, but a good friend, too. Allison Blackburn, Dr. Baxter's daughter-in-law, was very generous in sharing her memories in letters. Dr. Baxter's other daughter-in-law, Kay Baxter, was also helpful. Carl Greenwood supplied me with much-needed information over the months. University and library staff. USC librarian Claude Zachary and USC publicist Allison Engel gave me great assistance over the last couple of years. And archivist Aaron Spellbring gave me copies of a treasure trove of letters that Dr. Baxter wrote to his mentor, Harold Colton, from the 1920s to the early 1960s. James Blinn, CG artist extraordinaire, also gave me some interesting information. Head archivist Joan Miller of the Wesleyan Cinema Archives was most helpful in researching and obtaining Bell Science film stills from their collection. Dr. Baxter's former students gave me a good idea of how he taught in the classroom. These include Betty Fry, Pastor David R. Brown, Joseph Jarrs, Alan Simon, Meredith Churchill, William Owen, Theodore Cordes, S. Howard Wallace, and Florence Nishida. Other friends have also made wonderful contributions. Danny Kuhn, a new and very talented novelist, has given me great help and encouragement. Vincent Summers, a scientist who was much inspired by Dr. Baxter, also helped with the professor's family tree research. Special mention has to be given to three talented individuals and friends, Tom Sito, June Foray, and Lewis Kraft. Tom and I go back almost 20 years. He's a very talented animator who had worked for Disney and other studios over the years. We share a love of history, and in recent years, Tom has become a very talented writer and historian. He's now a professor of the practice of cinematic arts at USC, Dr. Baxter's old university. June Foray is one of those few people who deserve the title legendary. Though she's perhaps best known as the voice of Rocky the Flying Squirrel from Rocky and Bullwinkle fame, she had done scores of productions in the last 60 years or so. Lewis Kraft is a very impressive writer and chronicler of Western history, and a good actor to boot. His encouragement and friendship has meant a lot to me over the years. I also want to give a very special thank you to James Burke, a science historian who's perhaps best known for his Connections series. James took the time from his very busy schedule to not only read my manuscript, but also write a foreword. He was also very complimentary about the book itself. I am very grateful to him and to all. Foreword. This book is timely. It tracks and describes in intriguing detail what may be the first and last attempts over a 50-year period by those of us in the mass media to bring the general public to a better understanding of science and technology and the ways in which they shape our lives. From the first hesitant steps taken in the early 1950s, university stations' ETV producers, to the fast-moving computer-generated images of today's PBS shows, this book reveals how science programming has tried every means to make arcane gobbledygook informative and fun. Early seminal work was pioneered by men like presenter Frank Baxter and director Frank Capra, who got their stories across to the audience by means of cartoon characters, chalk and talk exposition, inspirational music, puppets, and sometimes earnest talking head scientists. Some of those first shows now look old-fashioned and amateurish, but at the time, any attempt to deal with science was cutting-edge stuff. Over the decades, as science and technology loomed larger in people's lives, especially in the form of the big science of the Cold War years, TV began to reflect the growing public awareness that what was happening in science labs could make your day, or bring an end to life on the planet. It became increasingly important to explain the relevance of science and technology, and above all, how it operated. So as the scientific disciplines proliferated and fragmented into ever more specialist areas of activity, more recent audiences were treated to ever more detailed investigations of such lifelong geek pursuits as the neuronal structure of maggot brains or event horizons in the vicinity of light-year-distant black holes. However, even in that last bastion of public service broadcasting, the BBC, it grew more and more difficult to justify budgets for low-viewer science shows when cheap cookery or house improvement programs would bring millions to the channel. It began to feel as if the early dream of television as an educative medium was indeed no more than a dream. But what has brought the question of mass media coverage of science and technology into stark relief, in particular because of the relentless commercial pressure to ignore serious subject matter in the quest for bigger audiences, is the advent of the Internet and the sudden exponential growth of information technology. Even scientists are finding themselves and their subjects of study increasingly computerized. Algorithms now explore the unknown where only the dedicated human researcher would venture. As for the general public, search engines for dummies give the impression that knowledge is freely and understandably accessible to all. Why watch science on TV, if you can find it there at all, when you can get all the information you want at the click of a mouse or the swipe of a finger? But the real question is whether or not the public any longer needs to understand science and technology at all. In the next few decades, nanotechnology will build ubiquitous interactive networks of trillions of dust mote-sized computers embedded in every object, perhaps including people, and capable of storing and managing the entire corpus of human knowledge. These motes will use big data and predictive analytics to scan the massive data exhaust that society generates with our every action in order to identify what people need and want, and then innovate to suit. Today we don't need to understand how a fail-safe refrigerator works to chill our food. Tomorrow the same will be true of genetic engineering or nuclear fusion power plants. We will leave such matters to the motes. If this is indeed what lies ahead, then part of the reason we will be ready for it will have been those early television efforts by Baxter and Capra and the others to introduce science to the general public and help to make it an embedded part of the general culture. We have much to thank them for. This fascinating and meticulously researched book explains why. James Burke, Menton, France. Introduction, Reflections of a Baby Boomer. One fall day in 1961, Mr. Leo Baish's science class at Calaroga Junior High School settled down to watch a 16mm movie. We waited patiently, but with a growing sense of anticipation, as Mr. Baish skillfully threaded the long perforated strip of celluloid through the Bell and Howell projector. Films were always welcome because they broke up the dull routine of schoolwork and transported us to places beyond the narrow confines of our Hayward, California classroom. When the movie began, the swelling strains of Ludwig van Beethoven's Eroica filled the classroom, and the title sequence announced the subject was Hemo the Magnificent, the story of blood and circulation. The subject was new, but the series and format were not. Hemo was part of an ongoing popular science series bankrolled by American Telephone and Telegraph, the parent company of Bell Telephone. An entertaining mix of live-action, science film clips, animation, and puppets, these films taught complex subjects in a thoroughly engaging way. Hemo starred actor Richard Carlson and Dr. Frank Baxter, with the latter as a kind of generic scientist called Dr. Research. Carlson had his moments, but to students, Dr. Baxter was the real star of the show. He was warm, witty, and charismatic, with just the right amount of mature authority to make you believe whatever he said. Baxter was like a beloved older relative in the mold of our other TV and film uncle, Walt Disney. Another science hero of mine was Dr. Earl S. Harold, curator of marine biology at the California Academy of Sciences in San Francisco. He was host of the local show Science in Action, and I probably saw almost every episode because I was a Bay Area kid. The shows were interesting, and once, when I was about 10, I had the thrill of actually catching a glimpse of Dr. Harold walking by the Steinhardt Aquarium. But when all was said and done, Dr. Frank Baxter was the man, the supreme teaching hero, even role model. I became a history teacher of my world. The irony is that Baxter wasn't a scientist at all, but a professor of English literature at the University of Southern California.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.